shall detonate the reality bomb!
I will build a great, great wall.
Some alien race to come down and threaten us.
Is the singularity near?
The truth is out there.
The military-industrial complex.
The seven mountains of the influencers of culture.
To be as gods, you know.
Change has come to America.
Catapult of propaganda.
From a secure location on top of the ridge in the heart of the beautiful Missouri Ozarks, this is A View from the Bunker. Now, here's Derek Gilbert.
Well, this is a surprise. We're trying something new, and hopefully this will be something that we can do on a regular basis. This is kind of sneaking in on you on a Monday evening, because this is a proof of concept test that we can actually do this live with the new setup that we got here in the Ridgetop Bunker. And so rather than promise that I was going to do this and then wind up not able to handle the equipment and have the initial program fall flat on its face. We're kind of sneaking one in on you here. So hopefully we can, I can make some sense over the next hour. And if not, just to know that at least we'll find out whether or not the equipment is going to work and this nifty new setup. Equipment has changed. We've got a little new technology since the last time I did a live program. Did View from the Bunker live, 8 years ago? So it's probably been 8 years since I've done the live program, and I've been missing it. Also, looking for an opportunity to maybe talk a little bit more about politics in particular than I get to do on a daily basis at Skywatch TV, because it really isn't appropriate at Skywatch TV. And even here on this program, while we will talk more politics than there, we're still going to try to do it with an emphasis on the real enemy. And that enemy is not somebody of opposing political views, but the supernatural enemy that the Apostle Paul warned us about, principalities, powers, the cosmic rulers over this present darkness. That phrase is a verse that we've been using a lot over the last, since 2005, when Sharon and I started PID Radio, which stands for Peering into Darkness, one of the earliest podcasts on the web. That was back in the day when Apple was still actively soliciting for podcasts to join the podcast store. Now you've got to jump through hoops and go through Podcast Connect and all sorts of other things. But we keep PID Radio alive, even though we've been very intermittent in our broadcast podcasting schedule over the last couple of years as we've gotten busy here at Skywatch TV. But we keep it because we like having the presence in the Apple iTunes store, the podcast store. So, what are we going to do on A View from the Bunker? It's not like we don't have things to talk about for certain. As we're coming up on the midterm elections, we are being told once again that this is the most importantest election ever. And this time, things may be that they may be closer to true than it's been in quite a long time. I really think the deep state was taken by surprise in November of 2016. They really expected Hillary Clinton to walk into the White House and for things to continue as just business as usual. And that's not what happened, of course. The last 2 years have been witness to, bear witness to the desperation of the deep state to correct what they see as our mistake. Our meaning you and I, the American voter, you and me. So we've witnessed, because of this, some bizarre things that have taken place. These charges that have been thrown at the president over the last couple of years, his collusion with Russia, alleged, his stories that I'm fairly convinced have been floated to very receptive media because it confirms their bias against this particular president, stories that were absolutely untrue for a couple of reasons. First of all, it convinced the American voters, who were growing more and more convinced anyway that the media is not telling us the truth, which serves Donald Trump's political purposes. But it also helped to flush out, I think, some of the spies inside the camp. I mean, if you know who's talking to whom Or rather, if you know which stories you floated through which people. I mean, this is a very old trick that the military around the world have used for, you know, centuries. You want to find the spy, float a fake story, and then see where that story turns up. And then you know who's talking to who. Well, I'm convinced that some of the things that have been reported breathlessly by outlets like the New York Times, CNN, Washington Post over the past 2 years have been planted by the Trump administration for that very purpose, which, as I said, serves his purposes in a couple of ways, and not least of which is convincing you and me, the American public, that the media really is all in to try to derail this president and overturn the results of the 2016 election. We've seen more of that over this over the last 48, 72 hours, and it's tragic because anytime there is a tragedy that involves somebody who has sold out to the enemy, and again, I'm talking principalities, powers, rulers of cosmic darkness, the incident becomes a political football. As you know by now, on Saturday morning, 11 people were killed by an anti-Semite in Pittsburgh. The Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, was shot up by a guy who faces life in prison, and rightly so. Not life in prison, but the death penalty. And again, rightly so. And yet, the media waited, 5 minutes before floating the meme that President Trump is really responsible for this. The suspect made no secret of his hatred for Jews. 46-year-old Robert Bowers of Pittsburgh is accused of the crime. He's facing dozens of federal charges, including 11 counts of murder. And this is going to be prosecuted, rightly so, as a hate crime. But as I reported on Skywatch TV today, it took just a matter of minutes for mainstream journalists, you know, Washington Post, Foreign Policy Magazine, which is a mouthpiece of the deep state's foreign policy cartel, foreign affairs cartel, and The Forward, which is a Jewish publication, it's been publishing for over 100 years, flat out connected President Trump to the deaths in Pittsburgh. I mean, it matters not to these journalists that the president is the most pro-Israel president that America has had probably ever. I mean, 20 years, 1995 or 7, that Congress passed the law requiring the move of the American embassy in Israel from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. And yet for 20 years, Presidents Clinton, Bush, and Obama kept delaying every 6 months, signing the waiver, until President Trump, who managed to coordinate the move on the very day that Israel celebrated its 70th anniversary of independence. Nor does it matter to these accusers that the president's daughter, Ivanka, married an Orthodox Jew, Jared Kushner, converted and is raising her children, Donald Trump's grandchildren, as Orthodox Jews. Yet, in the minds of otherwise rational, productive people, it makes perfect sense in their world that Donald Trump is simultaneously the best friend of Israel and the cause of this horrific attack in Pittsburgh on Saturday morning. It is irrational, the hatred for this president, and by extension, those who supported the president. And this is where it hits close to home for those of us who voted for Donald Trump, which, you know, includes 81% of what, American Christian evangelicals in 2016? I mean, think about that. 4 out of 5 evangelical Christians voted for Donald Trump. And in the minds of the elites, the minds of liberals, that means all of us are, by extension, at least complicit, if not supportive, of the type of hatred, violence, and evil that took place in Pittsburgh on Saturday morning. Now, as Christians, we are called to a higher standard, and it is difficult to live up to that standard. Well, it's impossible to live up to the standard that Jesus Christ set for us. I mean, he made that pretty clear. If you hate somebody, you've committed murder. If you lust after someone who's not your spouse, you've committed adultery. I mean, this is not analogous to adultery. It's not sort of like adultery. It's not kind of like murder in the spiritual sense, the supernatural sense. The scale that God uses to judge, it is murder. It is adultery. None of us getting into heaven on that scale. There is no way any of us can be that good. And so trying to live up to that standard when people are more or less accusing you of facilitating the murder of 11 people who were worshiping the creator of the universe is a little difficult. It's hard to be civil. But that's the standard to which we are called as Christians. It is difficult to turn the other cheek when somebody is accusing you of facilitating, as during the Judge Kavanaugh, Justice Kavanaugh now, confirmation hearings, facilitating or turning a blind eye to sexual abuse. It is difficult to be civil to people who, in their minds, are convinced that we're okay with somebody who has done that kind of, who has perpetrated that kind of evil on another, on someone else. Well, guess what, Christians? That's our job, and we knew it was hard. We knew it was dangerous when we took it. Jesus said, they treated me this way. They're not going to treat you any better. So, and as I said on Skywatch TV today, if this was easy, we'd already be doing it. The world would be a much nicer place. So, how do we adjust to this? How do we deal with this? How do we respond? I mean, you know, natural tendency is to want to take a sturdy stick and start, you know, thrashing about and knocking some sense into people, but that doesn't really accomplish anything. There's one thing I learned in a 20-year sales career is that people don't usually respond to being told that they're stupid and everything they know is wrong. That usually doesn't work. Then there are people who are not open to being persuaded, who are not interested in debate. And while we are not to back down from what we know is right, I don't see that there's any point really in engaging with people who are just in it for a fight. I mean, I love a good debate. I was captain of the high school debate team. Was pretty good at it. Not good enough to win any, you know, state championships. Qualified for the state championship tournament for a couple of years, but not that good. Good enough to get there, not good enough to win. But I enjoy the intellectual challenge of matching wits and arguments against someone else. I've had to learn to tone that down over the years because, again, in sales, it doesn't work very well. It doesn't work very well in a marriage either. When you've got a winner and a loser in a relationship, that means both parties lose. So that was, again, something I had to learn early on. But there are those who are not interested in the intellectual exchange of ideas and trying to debate, to reach a meeting of the minds, or at least a cordial disagreement. And we've seen this is true since 2016. I mean, the reaction to Trump's inauguration and the way it was reported in the media. Riots in Washington, D.C., described by the media as protest. No, it was violent riots, and this has been repeated over and over in the last 2 years as the media that accuses Donald Trump and his supporters of being okay with hatred against others of different religion or color, giving kind of, you know, a wink and a nod to Antifa and other violent protesters who aren't interested in just making their views known. They want to go out and, you know, punch a Nazi. And of course, Nazi defined as anybody who votes to the right of them. That's the world in which we live. Not really that new when you think about it. I mean, if you do a little digging in American history, you'll find that there are plenty of incidents over the last 200 years where political dispute or political discussion has ended up in fisticuffs, gunfire, and worse. So this really isn't new, but it is unfortunate because it's difficult to govern when people won't govern themselves. The only reason America is as free as it is, and we are an anomaly in history, by the way. Most of human history, people have not enjoyed the liberty that we Americans have enjoyed since 1776, or at least since the Constitution was adopted. But it is in large part because most of us have understood that at the end of our walk on this earth, we're going to be standing before the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent creator of the universe. And while our actions on this world aren't what will get us into heaven, we will be judged according to our actions, and our rewards will be portioned out accordingly. So at some point, we're going to be held accountable by the supreme judge of the universe. Most people in America over the last couple centuries have understood that. That is changing. And sadly, when you reach a point where the majority of the people aren't willing to live according to those standards, in other words, control themselves because they're going to answer to a higher judge someday, one who's got the power to determine your fate eternally, the only way to keep order is by, well, imposing it with force. So as things become less civil, things here will become less free in this country going forward. Tragic, but I that's the direction we're going. Now, I hope and pray, you know, just so that it is said and on the public record, what happened on Saturday morning is, I've used the word tragic. I can't think of a better word for it. It is horrific. It should never have occurred. This type of thing, this type of violence, this brutal evil act is why a number of pastors that I personally know are making sure that their congregations are well protected in a variety of ways. Just taking some common sense security steps to make sure that their flocks are not going to be without options if somebody decides to come in and do something like this. And sadly, I think as we as the years roll on, I think we may see more of this type of attack against Jews, against Muslims, against Christians, against one group or another, you know, or evil people within one group or another decide that they're justified in going ahead and harming fellow human beings, which is never, ever okay. So again, 46-year-old Robert Bowers now in custody, facing a number of federal charges, and hopefully we'll never see the outside. He's not ever going to see the outside world again as a free man. And at this point, the only light at the end of the tunnel for him is if he well and truly repents and accepts Jesus Christ sometime before he breathes his last, which may well be by means other than natural causes, because again, the prosecutor in the case is going to seek the death penalty. The other big event of the last, well, week, got underway toward the end of last week, was the so-called MAGA bomber down in Florida. And I haven't looked at the Twitter feed for Florida Man, but somebody pointed out that because of the idiosyncrasies of Florida law enforcement, that for some reason, there are an awful lot of stories out there that are truly bizarre and sometimes just really sad or evil that begin with the words Florida Man. And so somebody decided to turn that into a joke, you know, Florida Man, the world's worst superhero. But anyway, a Florida man is also in custody, 56-year-old Cesar Sayoc, S-A-Y-O-C, who sent pipe bombs, or what were described, rather, as pipe bombs to 14 prominent Democrats, including former President Barack Obama. Well, these bombs really weren't bombs in the sense that they could actually blow up and hurt anyone. And it was interesting the way the way the FBI Department of Justice press conference delivered the news about the arrest of Mr. Sayoc. The charges, and he is facing five federal crimes, including mailing an incendiary device and threatening a former president. And I likewise hope that Mr. Sayoc never sees the outside of a prison again. But it was reported, FBI Director Christopher Wray, I should say, in talking to reporters at the press conference announcing the arrest of Mr. Sayoc, delivered a very carefully worded statement. Now, he's very careful to tell reporters that the that these devices were not a hoax, but Sayoc, according to the FBI and Department of Justice, faces a maximum of 48 years in prison. And a former federal prosecutor, Andrew McCartney, has pointed out that if these mailed improvised explosive devices really were functionally explosive, they would fall under the category of the U.S. Code that governs weapons of mass destruction. That's Title 18, Code 2332A. And the potential maximum sentence under Title 18, 2332A is, life. So why a maximum of 48 years? It appears that the these bombs were not functionally explosive. I mean, according to Director Wray, and I'm quoting now, these pipes contained, quote, energetic material that can become combustible when subjected to heat or friction, end quote. Now, that could mean just about anything from wadded up paper to, of course, to actual explosive, but anything, pretty much, subjected to heat or friction is combustible. Combustible just means it burns. Doesn't mean it explodes. So whatever Mr. Sayoc was doing, and it's hard to imagine what he was doing. I mean, this fellow was living in his van. He's 56 years old, had been kicked out of his mother's home, apparently. And by no stretch am I trying to suggest that he didn't do what the FBI and DOJ is accusing him of, but they couldn't have ordered a more perfect suspect for these alleged crimes than Cesar Sayoc. I mean, do a search on the web for Cesar Sayoc van. And again, it's spelled S-A-Y-O-C. And you'll see what I'm talking about. Living in his van, I can understand why he'd want to put some stickers over the windows because, you know, you need a little privacy. But the stickers that he covered the windows with, I mean, this is like over-the-top pro-Trump. This is almost a parody. I mean, the stickers covering the windows. I mean, there's the artist's rendering of Donald Trump standing up wearing his suit, riding a tank into battle in front of an American flag and rockets bursting in air. And, make America great again. And Trump giving the thumbs up. Mike Pence giving the thumbs up. A sticker that contains a pejorative directed at CNN, and then a number of prominent Democrats with crosshairs superimposed, including Hillary Clinton. So if you were going to put somebody in front of the American public and say, oh, look, this guy is the one who sent these things out to Barack Obama, Maxine Waters, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, CNN, oh yeah, and Robert F. Trump De Niro, well, just look at his van. If they had ordered somebody from Central Casting, they would have toned it down some. So, you know, I don't know. Clearly this guy is not all there, but as with Bowers in Pittsburgh, Sayoc in Florida is being held up by the media and by some liberals as an example of what happens when you have somebody like Donald Trump lowering the level of political discourse in America. Really. All right, well, heavy sigh, and then try to move on, because again, as Christians, we're called to be, you know, okay, we rebuke this, we reject it. This makes no logical sense whatsoever to tie the president to, or any of his supporters, to something like this. I mean, there are a lot of us who think that Maxine Waters has gone off the deep end and who desperately did not want to see Hillary Clinton in the White House, but not so strenuously that we were going to actually try to harm either one of them. And look, we get the government we deserve. Sadly, some 30 years ago, well, actually more than that now, I'm older than I think, when I was in college, took a course, a poli-sci course called The American Presidency, and my professor said something that stuck with me because it was really insightful. It's one of those forehead slap things. It's so obvious, but you didn't think of it. And then when somebody else says it, it's like, of course, why didn't I realize this? Look at the abuse that Donald Trump, that Brett Kavanaugh, that Neil Gorsuch has had to endure over the last couple of years. Just look at the scrutiny that they and their families have been subjected to. Now, 35 years ago, there was no internet, so it wasn't that bad then. But even so, you still really, really had to want to be a senator or the president to put your family through the kind of abuse and intrusive media coverage that being a politician at that level requires. And today, with the internet, it is way worse. So what the professor said, which made a lot of sense, was that nobody in his or her right mind would want to be the president of the United States and put their family through this, which by extension means everyone that we elect to the White House is by definition insane. Sad, but probably true. And that puts us Christians in a conundrum of sorts. And we will talk about that as this test of what will become a weekly feature, I hope. View from the Bunker Live continues. I'm Derek Gilbert. We're back after this.
For thousands of years, mankind has debated how creation began. Ancient texts tell us the story. But today, the real message behind the pivotal account of the Garden of Eden has been obfuscated and lost. That is, until now. World-renowned author Carl Gallups digs up the hidden truths from the book of Genesis to finally give back the knowledge that was lost to the world. Find out what really happened in the Garden of Eden, what Jesus taught about Eden on the cross, and how the conflict between Jesus and the gods of antiquity is about to erupt on planet Earth, fulfilling biblical prophecy. In the new book, Gods of Ground Zero, this explains everything.
Warren Marcus helps unlock the meaning from the ancient Hebrew of God's priestly prayer of the blessing and unfolds the mystery of this end times revelation on how this prayer, written by God Himself, can help you in your daily walk towards supernatural health, divine provision, and the power and authority to fulfill your God-given destiny and purpose. Skywatch TV is proud to announce the Ancient Priestly Prayer of the Blessing special offer. Through Warren's revelatory book, you'll discover the supernatural power of the Hebrew language, that the Shekinah glory is the manifest presence of the Heavenly Father, that Jesus Himself, the High Priest of the New Covenant, prayed this divine prayer over His disciples as He ascended into heaven, and that He's ready to pronounce this divine prayer over you now. Plus, order now and receive this beautiful, authentic, numbered replica of the ancient priestly prayer pendant with chain. In 1979, a Jewish archaeologist, Gabriel Barkay, discovered two silver amulets in a cave opposite the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. Inscribed on the silver in the ancient Paleo-Hebrew was the ancient priestly prayer of the blessing. It is the oldest intact Bible scripture in existence today and is 400 years older than the Dead Sea Scrolls. The front of this incredible, beautifully crafted pendant is inscribed with the divine prayer written in the ancient Paleo-Hebrew as originally discovered. The back includes the prayer inscribed in English just as we have in our Bibles today. Also included with each pendant, you'll receive an accompanying priestly prayer mini booklet so you can carry the prayer with you and proclaim it over yourself wherever you go. But that's not all. Included within the pages of the mini booklet, a special free internet link where you can see and hear the divine prayer pronounced over you by Warren Marcus in the amplified Hebrew to English translation. And you can hear world-renowned messianic worship leader Paul Wilbur singing the divine prayer over you in Hebrew. Sold separately, these items hold a retail value of over $55. Yours now for your donation of only $30 plus shipping and handling. The Ancient Priestly Prayer of the Blessing special offer, available now at SkywatchTVStore.com. Order now or call 1-844-750-4985.
Driving the internet to think. This is A View from the Bunker. I'm Derek Gilbert, coming to you from a ridgetop location high above the beautiful Missouri Ozarks. And I appreciate you for finding us, because we kind of snuck this in on you tonight, which was kind of the plan. This is Proof of Concept, and glad you're here. We've got somebody in the chat room at Spreaker. We're doing this live via Spreaker.com, and if you've got the Spreaker app, or if you found us on the website, you can join in the conversation through the chat feature there. There will also be a specific View from the Bunker app coming very shortly. It's in the works right now. We'll be uploading it to the iTunes store here in the next day or so, and the Android version should be following very soon thereafter, so that as we get this thing underway, you'll be able to download this directly to your iOS device or Android device, and you know, just bypass all the other podcasts that just kind of clutter things up and get in the way of View from the Bunker. You can also follow us on Twitter. It's at View from Bunker, at View from Bunker on Twitter. Of course, I've got a personal Twitter feed. That's Derek Gilbert, at Derek Gilbert, D-E-R-E-K, Gilbert, at Twitter. Why did I split out the Twitter feeds, one for the podcast and one for myself? I don't know. It seemed like a good idea at the time. So anyway, the View from the Bunker Twitter feed will probably be more related to specific topics and guests here on A View from the Bunker, of which we can announce a few coming up in the next few weeks. Dr. Judd Burton will join us, and that will probably be on this Sunday's program, as we did kind of become a tradition here at A View from the Bunker. And you'll go back through the archives and see that just about October 31st every year, Dr. Judd joins us. He is the author of a book about the Nephilim, a scholarly look at the giants of Genesis 6. It's called Interview with the Giant, Ethno-Historical Notes on the Nephilim. He's also a fan of horror fiction. And so we generally will talk about the tropes of the season and the spiritual sources thereof, and then kind of turn around and discuss it from a Christian perspective. Is this something that we should really be celebrating as Christians? So that will be on Sunday. I'm going to talk to Josh Peck and Stephen Bankhurst, co-authors of an important new book called The Second Coming of the New Age. They've been featured on Skywatch TV for the last 4 weeks. Week number five of that series is being broadcast this week as I come to you on this Monday night. You can also get that on the Skywatch TV mobile app or the Skywatch TV channels on Roku or Apple TV. Dr. Mike Heiser joins the conversation for this, the fifth week of the discussion about their book, The Second Coming of the New Age. But we'd like to get the two of them on this program because, again, their book, which takes a strong look at how these practices are infiltrating the American Christian churches, I think very important. And then our friend Doug Woodward, author and analyst, will join us in a couple of weeks to talk about his brand new book. And so those are some of the guests lined up as we begin to bring back something I had been doing back in the 2010. That's a live version of A View from the Bunker. So as Christians, how do we approach politics? It's really easy for us to get caught up in the stupidity, really, and the anger and the hatred that is being flung back and forth through social media and by the mainstream media. In fact, things have gotten ugly enough on Facebook that I try not to, other than posting links to the daily updates, the 5 in 10 video report that I produce for Skywatch TV, I try not to weigh in on Facebook on politics much anymore. I mean, Facebook was a great way to connect with friends and family members who are other parts of the country. And now it's become just a big, you know, like a big game of dodgeball where, you know, you're getting hit from all sides with, you know, like in gym class, getting hit in the head with volleyballs at high velocity. And it's not a lot of fun. I mean, you know, show me pictures of your cat or your kids or something. But yeah, I'm just really tired of the echo chamber, first of all. And secondly, really tired of the anger that's thrown back and forth. Because as I said earlier, when it comes to discourse, you know, unlike a debate of the type I participated in high school, which was a standard debate. I also did some Lincoln-Douglas debating, which was even more interesting. But, you know, that's controlled circumstances, and things usually didn't get violent. I've done some reading about the way college debate has changed here in the last couple of years, and it's getting really silly, too. But that's not what takes place on Facebook. It's not what takes place on Twitter. It's not what you see coming out of the mouths of commentators on MSNBC, CNN, or Fox News, for that matter. It's hooray for our team, and the other guys are evil. And as Christians, is that really how we should engage with the society around us? I mean, we are called to be salt and light, and if we are telling the, you know, folks who disagree with us that, well, they're stupid and everything they know is wrong. Well, okay. On the issues, we might be correct. On the facts, we might be correct. But we're not likely to change any hearts or minds if we engage in that way. Now, being loving doesn't mean agreeing to everything that they say if what is being put out there is unbiblical. But our challenge is to try to find ways to do it that doesn't come across as angry, as hateful. And as I said, with some people, that's not going to be possible because they don't want to be persuaded. They don't want to know truth. As our friend Coach Dave Dobenmeyer so rightly puts it, truth sounds like hate to quite a few people out there. Well, sorry, can't help that. But if you present it in a reasonable, measured tone, yeah, you know, maybe those few people out there who are still in the middle, still undecided, who don't realize that they're being propagandized, they might actually be persuaded. One of the reasons, and this came up again in social media just within the last couple of days, engaged with somebody who was asking why I am not a big fan of debate regarding, you know, political or even theology anymore. And, I know how I got down that path. Dr. Mike Heiser had tweeted something out about not engaging in debate because it's often used as a substitute for actual study and real, you know, consideration of the issues. And he's right about that. I agree. I've been asked a couple of times to facilitate debates, and I did one a few years ago. A friend of mine debating biblical Christianity, Orthodox Christianity, against somebody who's convinced that the Emperor Constantine changed everything at the Council of Nicaea and totally twisted the message of the Bible, changed everything around. Christianity is nothing like what it was before Constantine got his hands on it. Well, factually, that is untrue. That is historically false. The Council of Nicaea wasn't where Constantine basically shaped Christianity to his own personal tastes. That's just not what happened. But the way the debate went down, my friend was a bit less kind, and I can understand why. He was frustrated that the other party in the debate was not being accurate in his representation of what had happened. But because of the way he came across, sadly, there were those who really didn't know anything about Constantine one way or the other, but perceived the other participant as friendlier and so concluded that he won the debate. Generally speaking, though, debates are opportunities for people of particular viewpoints to cheer for their champion, the person who holds their point of view, to smite somebody who disagrees in a public forum. And really, that doesn't serve any purposes. And I guess that's what I'm saying when it comes to politics. Are we really accomplishing anything if we're weighing in as the going into battle as the 101st fighting keyboardists and being really angry about the way we present our opinions, which again is an easy thing to do if you just watch the way things are being misrepresented by the so-called mainstream news media. And it's really easy to get angry about stuff, but, does that solve anything? Does that change anyone's hearts or minds? And hearts is really the key issue here, because as Christians, our prime directive is to change hearts, to make disciples of all nations, not to win the Senate, not to win the House. Not that those things aren't important, because those legislative bodies control how we live, but that is not where our salvation lies. Our salvation does not lie in stacking the Supreme Court with conservative judges. So, as Christians, then do we, and the other part of this conundrum, this problem as Christians, is if understanding that and in trying to live our lives according to God's will to the best of our ability, imperfectly, of course, but to the best of our ability, how do we vote for somebody like Donald Trump? I think this really caught a lot of observers by surprise. In fact, caught a lot of Christians by surprise. How can we vote for somebody with his very public, very flamboyant, very, well, unbiblical lifestyle in his past? Are we voting for a pastor in chief, a theologian in chief? Are we just voting for somebody who's going to be the best at executing the laws passed by our duly elected legislative representatives, our congressmen, and our senators? that's a tough call. And I think we all have to pray about it and be guided by Scripture as best we can. I think the way most of us came down on this issue in the last election was pretty clear. Again, 81% of evangelicals voted for Donald Trump, even though I don't think any of us would have called him an evangelical Christian prior to the election. We're learning some more about his faith now. He is, in the words of Dr. James Dobson, still likely a baby Christian. But when the choices before us are Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, well, you know, what are you going to do? And there are people that I know, people that I love, who could not bring themselves to vote for Mr. Trump because of the revelations that came out during the campaign about the way he's treated women in the past. Okay, I get that. But, you know, it's... you got to weigh that against Hillary Clinton's very public track record regarding foreign policy, for example, and issues of honesty. I mean, the foreign policy initiatives that she pushed during the Obama administration have left one failed state, that's Libya, very nearly a second, Syria, and that one has taken thousands and thousands of lives to bring back to some semblance of order. So how do you weigh an alpha male doing what alpha males do with attractive women? I mean, a billionaire who has beautiful women throwing themselves at him and taking advantage of that perk. And I know that's a flippant way of putting it, so forgive me for putting it that way, but was it the right thing for Trump to do? Assuming that some of these claims that were made against him during the campaign are accurate. No. But again, are we voting for a pastor in chief, a theologian in chief, a spiritual example, or just somebody who will execute the duties of the office of the President of the United States to the best of his ability and trying to choose the person best suited for the job in terms of skill set, ability, honesty, and, you know, how his views on the policies align with our own? You know, it's stuff like this that convinces me. This and, of course, the just ridiculous scrutiny that you have to go through and the pressures that people of faith endure in Washington, D.C. We've heard plenty about that from our friend Lieutenant Colonel Bob McGinnis. That convinced me that I just can't conceive of a true Christian being a successful politician at the national level. The pressures have got to be just insane, first of all. The temptations, first of all, but then the pressures to conform if you resist the temptations. I'd find it hard to believe that any true Christian who's just not an exceptional human being, and exceptional doesn't necessarily mean exceptionally good, just exceptional, like not normal, to withstand that kind of pressure, to stand up to the kind of scrutiny and the type of attacks that one undertakes, because politics is a blood sport, and we've seen that, especially here over the last few months. Having said that, we Christians probably would do well to get more active in local politics, where we've got more control over day-to-day issues, things like, what is this local school board doing? What is the city government doing? And I say that because it's kind of caught me by surprise here recently. Our daughter is grown and living on her own and happy, healthy, well-adjusted by all reasonable measure. But we work with a lot of folks who have children who are still in the elementary school grades and come to find out that they're being exposed to things at the elementary school level. Here in small town, Ozark, rural America, that I thought was only happening in big cities. political pressures, political indoctrination, really, coming from teachers in the classroom, but also the intrusion of technocracy into the classroom. Google is put a lot of money into making really low-cost Chromebooks that they're sending out there to schools, making it really difficult for other companies to compete. And, you know, computers are the way of the future, and so every kid's got to have one. But that means that these kids are connected to the internet all the time. And all these Chromebooks, of course, have webcams on them, which means that suddenly these kids are bringing home devices that are allowing cameras in their rooms, mom, dad, which is disturbing, and that they're being connected through these devices to websites that you, mom, dad, may not want the kids having access to. And again, I was just a little surprised here that in our corner of Missouri, and where we are here in the Ozarks is just about as close to the buckle of the Bible Belt of America as you're going to find. And yet here in towns of less than 2,000 people, this technology is finding its way into every child's hands. Well, you know, and I get that they're going to need to know how to use a computer in order to get by in the world. But as young as, how is it, fourth grade, I think, this year? And next year, I think it's going to go down to as young as first grade. And websites that you assume that they wouldn't be able to access, like, you know, YouTube, it takes the kids all of like 10 or 15 minutes to figure out how to bypass the security controls for that. Which I don't think is by accident. I mean, Google owns YouTube, and of course, the more eyeballs they get on their stuff, the more ads they run for the kids, for their advertisers and so forth. I mean, the kids, the eyeballs, our eyeballs, yours, mine, our children, our grandchildren, we're the product. We are the product. We might think that the programs that YouTube is putting out for us to watch, that that's the product. No, no, it's the other way around. We are the product that they are selling to their advertisers. And so this is why Google has no problem making these cheap devices and sending them out to every school in America, even here in these small, small communities in the middle of the Ozarks. And that's why some of our friends here that we work with are now taking their kids out of public schools and putting them in private Christian schools, and others are homeschooling. Because some of the indoctrination and some of the things that they're exposed to while under the care of these government employees is not what the parents want. And I mean no disrespect to teachers, because we were very blessed. Our daughter had some wonderful teachers through her school years. We were also blessed in that Sharon was able to be a stay-at-home stepmom and was able to keep an eye on what was happening inside the school during the school day. That's not a luxury that many families have, sadly. But I know that many people go into the teaching profession, education, because they truly want to teach the next generation of children and help to train them up in the way they should go. But government at higher levels, state level and the federal level, pushing things like No Child Left Behind, or, you know, what's the thing now that I can't even think of the name of the new program now that the public education system is not today what it was 50 years ago when I was just getting in and beginning it. So getting involved in politics at the local level, school board, county commissioner, city council, probably something we Christians ought to look at as an opportunity to not only impact how we live in our local communities, but to meet more of our neighbors and to engage with them one-to-one, share the hope we have in Christ Jesus. And I'm preaching to the choir here because this is not something that I personally have done ever. I actually find it a lot easier to sit behind a microphone or in front of a camera than to engage with people one-on-one. worked as an outside sales rep for 4 years, and that was about the hardest thing I've ever had to do. I had to force myself out of my comfort zone every single day. It's weird. It's counterintuitive. I found it a lot easier talking into a microphone, working on the air in places like Little Rock, St. Louis, and Philadelphia, than standing inside the office of a guy in a weld shop in Centralia, Missouri, one-to-one. That was a lot harder for me. So getting involved in local politics would be something that would really require a push outside my comfort zone as well. But at least at that area, at that level, we still have influence. At the national level, not so much anymore. And we've got a reprieve now with the gentleman in the White House who was elected in 2016. God only knows what will happen the next couple of years. God only knows what will happen next week with the midterm election coming up. So with all this talk, let me just be clear. I am not by any means suggesting that we Christians stay out of the political process. There are two paths to totalitarianism. One is to try to impose our will on other people, people who don't share our views. I mean, that is totalitarian. But of course, the other is to just leave the field entirely and let the enemy have its way. So we need to get out there. We need to vote. Do your homework on the issues. Do your homework on the candidates and cast your vote on November 6th. But just remember, at the end of the day, our goal is not about winning. And the media certainly casts these elections like they're sports contests. Fox News now putting out what they call power rankings. It's like, oh, okay, all right. Didn't realize we were keeping score in that way anymore, but in these elections. But winning, it's really easy to get caught up in winning and losing, forgetting that we're all in this country together. And as I said in the first half hour, just as in a relationship, if there's a winner, there's a loser. And oftentimes the winner and the loser can't wind up living under the same roof anymore. So if we're all going to make America great again, and more importantly, if we're going to make disciples of this nation, of the friends, neighbors, colleagues, family members around us, we just need to be careful about how we're engaging and make it a little more loving, if I can use that word. So, well, coming up in the next few weeks, again, Dr. Jed Burton will join us to talk about the spirit or the spirits behind Halloween. I think this year we're probably going to talk a little bit about zombies. That's not a subject we've covered in the past. Doug Woodward will join us. He's got a new book coming out here in a few weeks, so we'll talk about that and put out an invitation to Josh Peck and Stephen Bancars, authors of the brand new book, The Second Coming of the New Age. And we'll get them on to talk about why that subject is so important now, and how the New Age is beginning to influence the American Christian church. Hey, vftb.net is the website. Don't forget, Sharon and I, happy to be, honored to be, serving as the hosts for the Skywatch TV Wars of the Gods Tour of Israel. And I can see already I'm going to need longer bumper music. Or I'm just going to have to talk less. Anyway, you'll find more information about that at the website, vftb.net. There's a link there that takes you to lipkintours.com as we go to Israel next May 12th through 23rd, and hope you can join us. View from the Bunker is a production of Gilbert House and released under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial No Derivatives 4.0 International License, the opening theme by Kevin MacLeod. His website, incompetech.com. Our announcer, DC Good. Remember, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. I'm Derek Gilbert, and this is A View from the Bunker.